CEWT Talk is a weekly 20-minute podcast brought to you by the Continuing Education Workforce Training Division of Idaho State University's College of Technology. This podcast is part of our continuing outreach efforts, and the format is conversation. We're having conversations with businesses, professionals, entrepreneurs, community agencies, and in all cases, difference makers. You can find us on Apple Podcasts, Spotify, and SoundCloud. So subscribe today. Take 20 minutes and hear from people living in your community who are making a difference in your community. It's time to get started with CEWT Talk. Hello, everyone. This is Jason Batalden, the Assistant Director of Continuing Education Workforce Training here at ISU. And Paul, you're on the show with us today.
As always.
Well, that's not entirely true, but you know, you miss one show, I never forget.
I know, but I only miss them when Gary's here. When Gary's
here. That's right. That's right.
Does that say something?
Well, I don't know. I don't know. You know what's funny is Gary never gives me a day off. Well, no, I think we did have a season, an episode last year I wasn't hosting. So that,
yeah,
I shouldn't complain. And I don't, because somebody, by the way, Paul, just to let you know, somebody texted me today and just said how much they enjoy our podcast here at CEWT. Some really random person. I mean, I knew them personally to have their phone number, but I had no clue that this person was listening to our podcast. And I just told them how much I appreciate it and how much this is one of the very fun parts of my job. So
yeah,
I guess we can officially say now our listeners are up to 11. It's no longer just my parents.
Well, you're lucky because my mom doesn't listen to this. Yeah.
All right. Well, we got a show to get started. We've got an excellent guest with us today. We're excited to hear what she has to say. But before we can do that, I have to hit the magic button. And with that being said, I say welcome. And we know now that we have 20 minutes. So let's just get right to it. We have Natalie Christensen today. Natalie, you're with ISU Athletic. You know what, Natalie? Go ahead. You introduce yourself because I will mess it up.
All right. I'll totally do it. I'm excited to be here. I've never done a podcast before, so you might have to help me along. But yes, I actually have a really neat position that I'm actually hired through the nutrition and dietetics department as a dietitian, but I work 100% within the athletics department with the athletes and coaches. Mm-hmm. So it's a really good collaboration between the two different departments.
Okay. And so what do you do specifically?
So I get to do a lot of things, but as a sports dietitian, I kind of really focus on one-on-one nutrition counseling with the athletes. Any athlete can come to see me without cost. I do team talks, so I'll meet with individual teams and talk about specific fueling strategies or maybe different things they might need for that sport and for that team. I do cooking classes, which are very fun. Yeah, they're super fun. And then I tell people I do grocery store tours, and then people go, whoa, what? And they're actually a lot more fun than they sound.
Oh, okay. So I would imagine you do grocery store tours because you're dealing with basically young people who might be on their own for the first time in their lives. And, yes, you know, mom or dad had taken care of that for them previously. Is that correct?
Absolutely. Yes. And so many of them have spent so many years just honing their sport. Some of them were multi-sport athletes, right? So I have the best story. I had the most darling, like 300-pound athlete in my office one time. We were talking about food and menu planning and shopping, and he just got a little teary-eyed and he said, I miss my mom. Oh. It was awesome. It was so adorable. He's like, I don't know how she did it. She just had all this food and she was such a good kick and a good cook, and she did all the shopping, and man, she just amazing. And I said, you make sure you call her right after this meeting and you tell her how amazing she is.
That's right. Moms need to hear that all the time.
Absolutely.
The time and more often. So so you're helping these athletes, first of all, maintain good nutrition, but also you said, did you say the word fuel? Are you also helping them hone their bodies for the type of sports that they are in?
Absolutely. So yes, yes. There's just specific ways that athletes can fuel, maybe practice differently than after practice. So before going into practice, if you're a cross country runner and you're going to have a long run that day, you've got to make sure you fueled well. Carbohydrates are very important for quick energy that way. I was an athlete way back in the day at Idaho State, and I was a cross-country track and field runner, and we didn't have a dietitian. I didn't have mom and dad, you know, anymore at college, and I probably went to practice hungry probably 80% of the time. You know, you get up early, you have weights, you do school all day long, and then you rush to practice and change in the car, you know, because, and then you're traveling over the weekends, and it's just a pretty intense schedule. And so just teaching them how important, making sure they think about food as fuel that gives them energy and power and speed and agility. It helps prevent injury. And obviously it's going to help in their academic, it'll help them with their sleep, it'll help them with their mental health at the end of the day. And so nutrition is just a really, really important part of their training.
Yeah. You know, it's interesting. I guess the thing that connected me on this too is I'm wondering, and I'm only, I guess I'm sharing a little too much here. My son played some college football, and he too was one of those wanting to be 300 pound. He played offensive lineman, you know. And then when he stopped playing, it was a real challenge for him to try to get that weight down. How much of that diet while you're trying, you know, you meet those certain physical goals, do those translate to after the sport is done, or after your time in the sport is done, do those same principles kind of hold true, you know? Because I know my son did struggle with trying to lose a lot of extra weight after his football days.
Absolutely. And I try really hard to mention to the seniors too, like, come and speak with me for sure before you graduate, so we can make sure that we have, you know, all the tips and goals, and they kind of answer some questions before they head out into the real world of sitting on a Zoom meeting all day. Right.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. I would imagine that, you know, if they're active throughout their college career and they're involved in sports, they're burning a tremendous amount of calories that they're taking in. And then maybe after college, if they're not on a sports team, and you know, they're more sedentary, that could be, they're just used to this is the way I've eaten. You said you try to help them prepare for that transition. But I would imagine it's hard. I mean, I know I'm just me and I like to eat.
Absolutely. So one of the biggest things that I like to teach the athletes too, and as a dietitian, I'm always talking about lifelong habits of fueling. I always want to encourage mindfulness so that they pay attention to their hunger and their satiety cues. I don't want them to lose that. So when they're out and they're not hungry, hopefully they recognize they're not hungry. I always want them to pay attention to what their body is saying to them. I want them to have a really good relationship with food. So food isn't something they're afraid of or something that's like this mysterious something or other. I went out to eat with one of the teams, and one of the girls, me, Natalie, I'm going to eat these tater tots. And I said, great. I want you to choose to eat those tater tots. And I don't want to be the food police, but I don't want you to leave your college career saying, I have no idea how to eat. I have no idea how to make a healthy choice. And if you're going to choose mindfully to eat those tater tots, go for it.
Do it.
You know? Right. But I just don't want you to leave without knowing how to do it. So,
right. Natalie, I'm going to go ahead and quote you on that. So next time my wife and I go out to a restaurant, I'm going to say, I'm choosing to eat those tater tots. And Natalie says I can't. I'm not sure my diet goals are the same as the young lady at the team, but you know,
probably not.
Hey, I guess my question then is, you know, you brought up, you know, you yourself were a student athlete. And you kind of, you confessed that, you know, you went to practice 80% of the time as hungry. So how did this, how did you come to understand the importance of fuel and its impact on, you know, body performance?
So I think I went into nutrition as a collegiate athlete. I chose that degree and that major because I realized at a young age that what I ate and what I didn't eat really did impact my ability to perform on the track. I actually started realizing that in like middle school and early high school. Since then, I've found that I have a really fast metabolism, and then I struggle with hypoglycemia, which is a low blood sugar. And I find that a lot of athletes have that, a lot of runners do as well. And so I found that I couldn't eat a Rice Krispie treat, which to this day, I hate Rice Krispie treats, because I did that one day, ate some Rice Krispie treats and went to practice. And
I'm just guessing what the outcome was.
Yeah, it was lots of puking.
Yeah.
So I won't eat them to this day. But I just realized like there was specific types of foods that would make me feel good and strong. And I was resilient and I could run 400s in afternoon, you know, at good pace. And then there were foods that like Rice Krispies. I mean, I'm a goner in a half an hour. And so I really found power and self-empowerment, you know, in my performance when I figured out how to eat for myself. So that kind of spurred me into taking nutrition classes and getting really fascinated as I learned, because our nutrition and dietetics department, amazing professors, the classes are awesome. I was just fascinated and just really loved the whole subject and felt that even if I didn't work a ton, you know, if I wanted to try other things, that I could utilize this information every time I put something in my mouth.
Mm-hmm. Right on.
So
go ahead, Paul.
Yeah. Well, I you know, I imagine that for the most part with athletes, it's pretty normal for them to come in, you to give them advice and so forth. But I always, because we've had lots of episodes about this type of subject, have you run into athletes that you've trying to come up with a nutrition plan, but they also have, say, other factors that you have to take into consideration? One being, a lot of people suffer from this, depression.
Absolutely. Yes. I am currently working with our administrators to put together what we call an interdisciplinary treatment team, our peak performance team. So it's going to have sports psychology on it. It'll have nutrition. It'll have athletic training. It's going to have strength and conditioning. It'll have academics support. It'll have all sorts of support interdisciplinarily so we can collaborate, because mental health and nutrition are connected, which also affects academics, right? Which also affects, you know, their social and their sport. And so in order to give them that holistic care, that continuity of care that will help them perform and become wonderful, not just athletes, but human beings through their time at Idaho State, we just really need to work together to make sure we're meeting all of their needs, all of their wellness needs.
Yeah. You know, Paul, when you brought that up, I didn't jump right to the depression. So I appreciated that mental health component. But then I was also thinking, you know, people who have, you know, dietary limitations due to allergies and those types of things. I suppose that presents its own challenge when trying to create diets for individuals that need specific types of food to produce, get, you know, specific types of fuel.
Absolutely. I've got athletes with celiac disease, with nut allergies, with type 1 diabetes, all sorts of, and they're amazing, right? They're Division I athletes, and they have these chronic conditions that are outside of their control, but they are able to make it work. And it's super important to give them the access to the foods that they need and the knowledge that they need to stay healthy.
Very cool. So it's kind of fun. I guess the way we started this whole conversation ago was kind of like the enjoyable parts of your job. And from what I'm hearing, the best part about your job is that you kind of get that hands-on interaction with students, right? That you're there, you're dealing with, it's not a theoretical practice, so to speak. You're not in theory, right? You're dealing, right. You're involved, engaged in their lives. So that's gotta be some kind of enjoyment and fun.
I'm super passionate about this, and athletes are like the best because you take the science and then I translate it as best I can into food, right? And something meaningful that they can take with them, and they will do it. They are motivated. They are, you know, type one or type A. What is that? That like super motivated.
Type A, yeah.
Type A. And they're super competitive. So if I ask them to increase their calories 300 to this for this week and then let me know how they feel, they can tell. They'll do it, first of all. And then they can feel the change in their body. And it's very motivating to continue on a path of making nutrition changes so that they can feel better, compete better, jump higher. I just love this particular population. They're really motivated and fun to work with.
Do you share this information much outside of the arena? Is there much application for this information for, you know, the guys like Paul and I who spend a lot of time on Zoom meetings and, you know, we got our Fitbits and our step trackers and we're scrambling just to get.
And we want those extra helpings of tater tots.
Yeah, we love tater tots.
That's awesome. But absolutely. I meet with coaches too, who are generally more active than some population, you know, they're athletes themselves. So I like to meet with coaches. I have a Instagram page where we're posting nutrition information. It's @fuel_bangles. If anybody wants to follow us on Instagram, Twitter, name. And I try to post good information that really can be, like I said, I try to talk to them. The things I teach, I hope that they can be utilized lifelong. I'm not putting anybody on a quick fad diet that's going to make major body composition changes in a short period of time just for, you know, we really watch them and try to keep them in a healthy relationship with food, excuse me, and on a track for mindful eating, things that happen, you know, slowly that they can do as adults as well.
So Natalie, I'm a little portly right now, but at some point I was trimmer and I hiked a lot, but in my youth, I was really heavy, really heavy. And I found that I kept a track of my calorie intake, and that helped a lot. Do you sometimes have students keep a journal of their intake so that you can review it and go, okay, let's see what the problem is. I need you to write it down and we'll review it.
Absolutely. So depending on what their nutrition or weight goals might be when they come to see me, I will do a 24-hour recall or a 3-day food recall. Elite athletes and college students are cutting their budget. Their cooking skills are, you know, kind of at a minimum. So they usually eat the same things regularly. They have food patterns that they follow. And so it's not generally too hard for them to give those to me in a meeting. And then I can quickly go through there and I find gaps. I might see some deficiencies or I might see some overages, right? Maybe there's too much of something and I can do some quick calculations and really pull that athlete back and help them make what we call a fueling schedule. So I create a fueling schedule for them based on their needs, but starting where they're at, if that makes sense. After they've told me what they do and when, and when their classes are and when their practice is, how can we make, you know, small changes and then hopefully over time, more changes so that it meets their needs over time.
Very good.
Yeah.
So just jumping subjects a little bit, Natalie, and you brought this up earlier. You're a homegrown gal, right? Can I say that? So you're a Pocatello native?
I am.
Okay. Pokey High grad, was that or no?
Yes. I graduated from Pocatello High School.
Right, okay. ISU. So I guess it's encouraging. I guess I, you know, your passion for the sport, your passion for obviously, you know, the athletes that come in, but underlying all that too is probably that connectedness to this community and the passion for the school itself too. I'm assuming.
It's true. Yes. And yeah. I have people from the high schools that know me, you know, have friends and family members. And so I'll meet with some of the high school teams because I know them or they know me or, I really have a lot of followers on social media that are friends, family throughout. I love Pocatello. I love Idaho State. I have family members at Highland. I have family members at Pocatello High School. See? Plus, I'm alma mater there, and my kids go to Century. So
you got them all covered. Ah. you got all your bases covered. That's good. No, I guess
I love all of Pocatello.
I didn't mean to put you on the spot, but I, you know, I think there's something to be said too, right? Is the ISU and coming back to ISU and working with the students at ISU. And, you know, it just there's something about that. I think that, yeah, I'm not going to say it's unique to our college and our school, but it sure is. You know, I can't tell you how many people Paul and I talked to on the show, you know, that are here and, you know, homegrown products and went to school here, stayed here and raised their family here. And that sure is a neat little quality and a neat little thing to run into all the time. I that was just my little comment there. So.
Yep. I love it.
So Natalie, I have to ask, since you're all entrenched in, you know, providing nutrition for the athletes all the ISU programs, do you actually attend the games?
Oh, yeah. I can't sit there and preach to them on how to fuel if I don't go and cheer for them.
There you go.
Yeah, it gives me clout and I love it. Like, they see me in the notice too. They notice if I come or, you know, when I come in late, they'll point it out. So I love to come in. I don't know. It's like the icing on the cake to go and watch them perform and maybe see them perform even better after meeting with me or something so I can feel all special. But I love to watch them perform. It's very good. It's very, very fun.
Very good. So, and that kind of thought too, the other thing too, Natalie, was I was thinking now, hold on. I'll ask this last question and just don't worry. Paul and I violate the 20-minute all the time. You mentioned earlier you've got children. You know, and you mentioned earlier, no Rice Krispie treats. But there's gotta be there's that translation between job and home. And so I imagine the kids get some cookies or brownies every now and then.
My kids get plenty of sweets.
Oh, there we go. Okay.
Sure. Yeah. So that is an interesting question. I mean, how much of your work life do you like bring over to your home life? And, you know, you want to see your kids eat well. But do they look at you going like, you're the food police?
Sometimes. Yeah, I had my daughter say the other day, because I was like, to a friend, I said, I would really like to have a recipe. I want that recipe. And my daughter said, you don't need any more healthy recipe, moms. No more healthy recipes, which I thought was very funny.
Well, but you know, your
I have
title...
been called dessert snob.
Ah,
your title as mom automatically makes you the food police. So, you know, that's kind of the rule of parenting, right? When you're a parent, you automatically become food police. So, Natalie, we did run out of our 20 minutes. So, obviously, you'd mentioned earlier your Instagram account, and just remind our listeners, I'll go ahead and include that in the description. And please connect with her. And Natalie, I'll be honest, that's how I found you. We follow each other on our sweet Instagram, and I was following you and then watching your foods that you put up, and I thought this would be a great conversation, and I can't tell you how much I appreciate you coming on our show and just kind of cold turkey, right? I bet that was weird to get that email that says, hey, you want to be on a podcast?
I was actually really excited because this particular position that I'm in, we're funded through Dairy West. Is this SCORE program, the sports nutrition program. I don't know if people have heard of Dairy West, but when they they help me a lot. They help, they fund it through the dairy farm families in Idaho, but they really, it was them that said, you got to do social media. You've got to get out there and do all this Instagram and Twitter, and kind of guided me through it. And it's mm-hmm. really important to them to really reach more than just the ISU community, to reach outside of that. And so I've learned a lot through social media. It's been good for me. And then with Corona, you know, the students are off campus right. and I'm not able to meet with them one-on-one. Right. And so it's been awesome to utilize that social media. So I'm glad to hear you found me there and that it's yeah. been useful in even more ways. So that's okay. great.
Are there any other social media links that you want to shout out while we got you on that you're besides your Instagram?
I've got Twitter. Okay. Twitter. Some people like Twitter better. I enjoy Twitter, and it's just @fuel_bangles as well.
Okay. Very cool.
Yeah.
Okay.
Well, Natalie, thank Fine. You for being on the show today.
Yes.
And it was a pleasure. Very much. Yeah,
so. Yes. Thank you so much. It's been really fun. Hey, you said you like to cook. Would you ever be interested in doing a stream cooking thing with us?
Absolutely. That would be fun.
See?
That would be fun, wouldn't it?
We do. We have this, we do In the Kitchen with Sweet, and we're doing a live stream cooking class coming up here in February. So
really?
Yes.
So where do you do it?
We cook it. We have a kitchen in our facility, in a commercial kitchen, and we'll be doing butter chicken, Indian food, butter chicken.
Yeah, butter chicken.
And I made that for dinner last night.
Oh, there you go. See? So, yes. And so you'll interact. The cook, the instructor will be there, and it'll be live stream, so you can type up questions, and it'll be a really cool thing. So
that is so good.
But, yeah. So I got a cheap plug for our own program. Thank you very much, Paul. That was very cool. So if you are...
I'm here to serve.
I know. We're almost good at this podcast stuff. We're almost good at it. So with that being said, though, for those of you listening, if you have questions and about Natalie and about the SCORE program, obviously reach out to her through Instagram or Twitter. Or you can contact us at cetrain.isu.edu. That is cetrain.isu.edu. And our phone number is 208-282-3372.
All right.
Did I do it? I did it. You don't understand. That's a big deal, Natalie. That's a very big deal. So anyway, thank you, Natalie and Paul, and thank you for being on the show. And hope everyone has a good year, I guess, because technically this will be still starting out in the year. So very good.
Yeah. Yep. Okay.
Thanks for having me.
Yep.
No, thank you so much.
You bet. Thank you.